Hi, this is Joan Sparks, and welcome to Flute Pro Shop on the Road. I'm here today with Professor Trudy Kane at the Frost School of Music, University of Miami in Florida. It's great to see you, Trudy.
It's nice to have you here.
And I'd just like to let you all know that I've known Trudy since the early 1990s when I took lessons with her for several years. I would go to New York from Delaware, and we would have double lessons, and I would leave exhausted.
Sure. I always wondered about that.
But it was a wonderful way to give me a whole new perspective on things, and I'm sure that's what you do for your students here.
I certainly try.
Well, I was interested in preparing for this interview to read a little bit about the history of the University of Miami, and I didn't realize that it was considered by the land developers of the time as a conduit from the United States to Central and Southern America. And when the school was founded in 1926, it was founded as a conservatory of music and a college of arts and sciences, which I thought was amazing.
Isn't it?
I don't know of another school that was founded like that.
I think there are a lot of, even the faculty here, who don't know that. So thank you for bringing that out.
Sure thing. And then the land developers of the time, Mr. Merrick, Mr. Penny, and Mr. Flagler, saw this as a critical part of the Southern Florida expansion and development. And at that time, the city of Miami only had like 100,000 people in it.
Well, I know that Mr. Merrick, when he planned out Coral Gables, did include in his plan a plan for the university.
Interesting. And so with this history, that's got to be part of what attracted you to the Frost School of Music.
Well, there are so many things that attracted mm-hmm. me. I came here first as a guest, mm-hmm. and I gave a number of master classes. Mm-hmm. And it was a wonderful experience because the level was much higher than those of us in New York had any idea.
Really?
And what was even more wonderful was the faculty. Not only the level of the faculty, but the personalities of the culture of the faculty. Mm-hmm. The culture is one of warmth and being supportive, and not only of each other, but of the students. And it's just such a lovely place to be and to work. And I'm really enjoying it here.
Oh, that's great, because one of the things I wanted to talk to you about was your transition between being a key figure in the New York music scene and then coming here to Coral Gables.
It's been wonderful. It's been absolutely wonderful. I have to say that I haven't missed a beat. We sold the apartment in New York, moved down here, and I started working, and it's just been wonderful. Having a flute studio, all strangers, of course, that I hadn't chosen, but it was wonderful to work with them. They were lovely young people, and I know you're going to ask me later about the audition class, but one of the things that I did initially was I made a class where we went through entire parts of orchestral music. And I thought I'd have 3 or 4 people in that class, and 10 people showed up.
Wow.
And it was a wonderful way for us all to be together. And it was great. It was really great. And they were so eager to learn from me, and it just made it wonderful.
So the audition class was an innovation of yours?
The audition class was absolutely my innovation. As I said, I began with that class where we had 10 people and we were going through entire parts of music. Mm-hmm. We did that the first semester. The second semester I realized that it would be better, the students would be better served if we were able to concentrate more. Mm-hmm. So for the next 2 semesters, I had a class with a maximum of 5 people. And we did indeed go through entire parts, but we would spend weeks on them, like Daphnis. Everyone would learn every part. Mm-hmm. And at that point, a conducting teaching assistant was assigned to me.
Ah.
And so I didn't have to conduct anymore. And I could just sit and listen and make comments and mm-hmm. suggestions and whatever. And that was very good. And as good as that was, I began to realize that, unfortunately, the culture of being a professional musician includes taking auditions.
Yes, it does.
And as much as I wanted them to learn entire parts, they really had to be prepared for auditions. So I then began the audition class. And what I do in the audition class is simply this. 1 week, we go over 3 to 5 excerpts. And that means I go over them with them, we play them, we talk about the difficulties of them. And the next week, we have a mini audition. Those excerpts.
So they've got a week to prepare.
They have a week to prepare.
And then they stand up in front of their peers.
That's right. And they play the excerpts. And we do that throughout the semester. Now, what you're going to hear today, which is the last day of classes, is going to be a mini mock audition. They're responsible for everything that we have worked on this semester. And they do know, actually, guys. I wrote to them last night that they will be playing 5 of the excerpts today in front of the class as the beginning of this. This one today is really practice because next week will be their final exam.
Ah.
The final exam is going to be, I've blocked out 3 hours in the recital hall. And we will have 2 rounds of auditions. And they will play a shorter audition, although it will be longer than today's, and a final audition. I'm not declaring winners, I'm just giving them practice of taking the audition, and the final audition will be a longer audition. And so between these 3, they probably won't be required to perform just about everything we worked on this semester.
Which is going to be 20 or 30 excerpts,
it's
right?
Probably closer to 20, but 20, yes,
but
yeah.
That's still like a normal audition list.
Yes,
there are
exactly.
Typically 20 excerpts on an audition list.
Exactly.
So this is like real life.
Exactly. And you know, I've had students leave here and they go out and they audition for graduate school and they do really well playing their orchestral excerpts because they know them.
Right. And they've been through the process X number of times.
Exactly.
And they feel like they know what it's like. They know what to expect from themselves.
Exactly. And, you know, I say it over and over and over again, the only way to practice taking auditions is to take auditions. Mm-hmm. So although this is not the same as an audition environment, it's still a little safer. It's still practice.
Well, and you're not paying airfare and hotel room and all the rest
right,
of it. You're
right.
Really getting that kind of practice in school, which is what school's supposed to be.
Right, exactly.
That's
exactly.
Wonderful. What yeah. A great opportunity for them. So when you were mentioning earlier that the level of playing was much higher than you expected,
yes.
And that you had a studio that you didn't choose, now when you hear the students that auditioned for the Frost School of Music, do you hear a similar rise in quality of students, or?
Well, certainly the level of students has gone up.
Mm-hmm.
The Frost School is getting a very nice reputation, as is my studio.
That's
so
great.
We're attracting a lot of wonderful players, and it's a pleasure to hear them. The sad thing is to have to choose between them.
Oh, I can't imagine.
Yeah.
That's got to be very tough.
Yeah.
Is there a piece of advice that you would give to students that are going out and getting ready for their undergraduate or graduate auditions?
Well, one of the things that I suggest is that they go out and visit schools.
Oh.
And if possible, take lessons.
Mm-hmm.
And find out with whom they're the most comfortable and where they're the most comfortable. Because not everyone is going to be comfortable in the same environment,
mm-hmm.
or with the same teacher.
Right.
And then if they have to make a recording, I would emphasize over and over and over again that when a recording is listened to, people assume that you've had as many times as you like to redo and redo and redo. And that this is your absolute best.
Right.
So make sure that it is indeed your best.
Right, right. And we were just talking about me doing a little video for my business here, and I did one excerpt 5 times and ended up, the first one was actually.
And there's nothing wrong with that, and that's probably right. Often the case.
Right, right. You can start tweaking and thinking,
right.
Oh. But yeah, and so as you have been here, occasionally I've heard that you will play in some of the orchestras, opera orchestras, and bring your students in as well?
Well, I was, when I got here, they asked me to play in the opera, and I really felt that that was a part of my career that was over.
Right.
And what I said was, I will be happy to help out if you get stuck.
Mm-hmm.
So they did get stuck
of course.
A few times, and I did help out. And in the meantime, they asked me for recommendations from my students. And I will say that one of the most thrilling things that I did was to play opening night of Turandot, and the other 2 flutists in the section were my teaching assistants.
Oh, fabulous.
It was wonderful. And, you know, as I was playing, I thought, my God, I mean, they're really right with me in a way that I probably had never experienced quite like that. And I realized, of course, they're my students.
Yes.
You know, we've been working so closely together. Yeah, it
well,
was wonderful.
I experienced the flip side of that, and I can tell you what a thrill it is to sit in an orchestra next to your teacher.
Yes.
And just, you know, you watch, you observe, and you find out you're doing the exact same thing.
Yes, so, it's wonderful. I had that too, yes.
It's a wonderful way to learn.
It is a wonderful way, and I was very thrilled to give my students that experience.
Yeah. Well, I love in talking to you how centered with the students you are and how dedicated you are to the Frost School of Music, and I'm sure this is such a great experience for everyone that's part of it.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. So Trudy, it's been great seeing you again this semester, and I guess the next time we'll be together, or I'll get to see you, is at the Florida Flute Association Convention, which is the last weekend in January, which for a northerner like me, what a treat.
Oh, yes. Actually, the first time I went there, it was quite cool.
Oh, no!
But usually it's warm. And I'm so excited to go this year in particular because I'm bringing the flute ensemble, which is made up of all our performance majors. And we're doing an extraordinarily special concert, which we premiered here, which at the time included four world premieres.
Wow.
Five pieces, four of them were written by our own faculty. And one by Irv Monroe.
Oh, really?
Who did come to the concert, and of course he will be at the concert in January, and we will have all our composers there as well. It's a wonderful program, and I hope a lot of people will come.
Well, I'm going to make sure I'm there for sure, because I was supposed to be here for the premiere and missed it, so
oh, wow.
I will not miss this one. This is Joan Sparks with Flute Pro Shop on the Road, and I want to say thank you to our guest Trudy Kane from the Frost School of Music at the University of Miami.
Well, thank you so much for coming and joining us here.